to my review of Mission Impossible 2. Yes. I know it's been quite a few days since the previous review, but I've been incredibly busy. I'm moving house. A lot of things are happening at the moment. So yeah, but Mission Impossible 2. So the plot is that Tom Cruise is back as Ethan Hunt, and Ethan is sent on a mission to find and destroy this infectious disease called the Chimera. And he is told to recruit this woman called Naya Nerdoff Hall, I think her name is. And there's this other guy who she was used to have a relationship with, Sean Ambrose. He is a former IMF agent, and he's planning, he's head of this terrorist organisation, and they're planning to basically use the disease, get funding from this man called McCoyne, I think his name is, and use the disease to wipe out, you know, all of the world, basically. And he's also got the cure as well, so, which I believe is called Bellerophon. So that will counteract the effects of the disease, and things start to happen from there on. You know, Ethan and Naya fall in love, and she eventually gets poisoned. It's poisoned from the disease, and so Ethan has to go on a desperate mission to save her. So, sorry about that. Pause there. Mission Impossible 2, directed by John Woo. That's not Woo as in W-O-O-H, that's W-O-O. this film is very, very different to the first one, in terms of tone. The first one feels more like a genuine kind of thriller. This one feels like more of an action, shoot-em-up kind of film. But I think the first thing to say is, meh. It's just a very meh film. What can I say? Mission Impossible 2 fails to capture the intrigue and the essence of the first movie. I mean, what made the first movie good was the fact that, you know, you had this intriguing story. The fact that Ethan was framed for murder and all of his team died, and, you know, then, I mean, the only issue is obviously the villain in the first one, we didn't really know his motivations, which was a shame, but at least it was an intriguing story. This feels to me kind of dumb. It feels like they kind of struggled with this one. It feels like they didn't know what to do with it, to try and think of a story, and it feels like it's a bit lazily written. It's like, oh, a virus that we want to infect. Well, I mean, it's a plot that's been rehashed countless times, so it's nothing that's gonna completely blow you away. I mean, but you know, let's get on to the film. I think it's not as good as the first film, and it kind of fails. I don't think John Woo as a director was the best choice. I don't think his direction was very good. I feel that because my problem is, I feel that John Woo tried to focus too much on making the film look cool rather than the film actually being cool. Now, you might ask me why I say that, but here's the thing. There's a big difference between looking cool and being cool, you know. What makes a film really cool is that it has substance, and it has, like, everything comes together, and it looks amazing. You're like, wow, this is so cool, like, I'm embracing this, like, but if all the elements don't work, then your movie doesn't, if you don't focus on grounding the movie with the story, the script, and the characters, you lose the plot, and this movie kind of loses its way. I mean, I don't know what else to say. It's just a movie that doesn't know what to do. It's a movie that has a basic plot, it has a pretty dumb plot, and it has too many characters and it bothers to develop. It's just like, oh fuck it, we got this many characters, Let's not even bother developing them. I mean, it is good in the sense that Tom Cruise is a bit better in this film. I think his acting is a little bit better in this film, and he doesn't whisper as much as he does in the first film. But Tom Cruise is good. It's nice to see him return, and he's an engaging screen presence. He's nothing amazing, but you know, he's fun. He's fun to watch in this film. Luther comes back. If you don't know who Luther is, he's the black guy from the first one who does all the computer stuff, and he communicates with the headset. He's a really cool character. I feel that the villain, Sean Ambrose. Actually, what am I doing? Sorry, I should talk about the cool thing. To explain my analogy earlier, I feel that this film relied on visuals more than actual substance, like story and plot and characters and direction. It relied on visuals and the visual action and stuff, like cinematography and visuals. Like, it's a movie that looks really cool. Like, I it's good to look at. It's great. I mean, you know, there are some great landscape shots. It's really well shot. And there are some great places where the film was made. Some great stunt work as well. Especially near the beginning when Ethan's climbing the cliff. But like, a lot of the action is done in slow motion. Now that really baffles me, because normally an action scene is meant to up the tension. So naturally it's going to be quite, you know, your heart wants to race, you know. And, you know, with the first movie, you got some pretty heart-racing action sequences. You got that train sequence at the end. That moment when Ethan's on the harness and going down, and like he's about to be, you know, he's about to, and when he drops the knife, that in the first one, that was brilliant. There's so much tension. The action scenes, whilst they're very well constructed, lack tension, and I think that's because John Woo focuses too much on making the film look cool. And you know, the fight scenes, they're just overdone. Like the choreography, like that final fight between Ambrose and Ethan, it goes on for way too long. And you know, it's just like a load of karate ninja stuff that it's a bit over the top, to be honest. I mean, I never really understood why it was done that way. But no, the action is good to look at, but up to a point you go, it's just the same. It's all in slow motion, and you know, what's with the music? I swear, like this film has such a weird soundtrack. I mean, it's not a bad sounding soundtrack, but I think you wouldn't hear this for a Mission Impossible film. This isn't a score that I would necessarily consider as a Mission Impossible. You know, sort of, usually the sort of spy scores would be like kind of like a dun 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 dun, like really sort of intense, and you know, like dun 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 dun. But like in this one, the score, you have a lot of like choir sort of like they try to make it too emotional, and it feels weird. It feels out of place. The composer has done a good job in sort of constructing it, but they haven't really thought about how it could fit with the tone of the movie. And that's the problem. It's a soundtrack which sounds good, but not for Mission Impossible. And they do it every time they slow down, like, an action scene, or they try to up the tension with Naya. It feels weird. You just sit there going, what the fuck? I mean, I know what they're trying to do. They're trying to make it dramatic, but you can have a fast-paced action scene and make it really dramatic, and then you can cut away and then slow things down, like that scene at the end, like with the motorbike chase, like there's like slow motion action. You could have had that really fast and then cut away to her walking across the cliff. You know, if I were directing the film, I would have edited it in completely a different way. The editing is a bit poor, to be honest. I mean, the movie moves at a snail's pace for like the first half an hour, which is a bit of a problem, I think. I mean, it drags on, which doesn't help. But once it gets going, it picks up. It makes for a little bit more of an insane experience. But The villain, Sean Ambrose, not great, but I think the actor tries, but the writing is just like he doesn't come across as menacing. You're just like, he's just this guy who's after world dominance. It's cliche, you know. He wants to dominate the world, and he wants to act like he's in control, and he's a cliched villain. He's a cliched villain. It's not the actor's fault. The actor does well for what he has. The actor gives a good performance, but the character kind of fails to be menacing purely because of the writing, and they didn't write him as a completely original villain. I mean, you kind of understand his motivation, I guess. But at the end of the day, he's kind of wasted. A lot of the characters are wasted. But yeah, no, I mean, another character I've got to talk about is the lead female, Naya, played by Thandie Newton, who, I feel, I mean, whilst, don't get me wrong, she's pretty sexy. I mean, she's very skinny, but I still think that she's a little bit attractive. I think she's a little bit wooden in this film, I have to be honest. Thandie Newton didn't really compel me. Like, there are some lines you just sound a bit off, like she's a bit wooden. It doesn't quite work, her performance. I mean, she's not completely terrible, but there are some lines where you go, ugh, like when she's like, "I'm now worth £38 million." You know, it's like she's really laying on the accent. Take the British accent. I mean, I think she is British anyway, but even so, she does kind of fail to come across as like. The thing is, I kept thinking when I was watching the film, I don't really know what side she's on. I know she kind of is meant to be helping Ethan, but at the same time, you can't help feeling because we are told that she's a thief, that, you know, at any moment we could be thinking, oh, she might be trying to steal something from Ethan. You know, how are we to know what's going to happen? I don't think it's ever really made clear, her intentions. Her intentions are kind of unclear. But what I do like, and probably the best scene in the movie, is when she has to make a choice between the two men. And, you know, like she's got the gun with the chimera, and then she has to choose like who to give it to, and then she just injects herself. But that's quite a powerful scene. That's done well. You know, that was the best directed scene in the film. But the movie's a little bit all over the place. It's very clunky. I mean, the action's well constructed, but again, it's just too slow. Like, there's too much slow motion. I don't know why they decided, the editor decided to do that. And I don't like sort of the alternate version of the Mission Impossible theme. You know, the down, 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 like the electric guitar version. In the end, it's not a total fail because there are some well-constructed action sequences. Tom Cruise is better than he is in the first film, and there's some great stunt work. But overall, it is very weak. It has a weak plot, weak villain, weak writing. The script is cheese. One thing I also have to say is they kind of invoke at the beginning. Ethan and what's her name? Naya kind of fall in love in the beginning. I mean, after they have a bit of a car chase. I think that was kind of ripped off GoldenEye. That chase scene was ripped off of GoldenEye when Brosnan and Xenia are chasing each other around in the cars. But this one looks a bit more high octane. And then they just sort of end up bedding each other, which is a bit weird because then she sort of questions him afterwards. But, I mean, you know, he obviously sort of basically admits to her that he's a spy. I mean, if I were him, I would have, even if I was recruiting her, I would have kept it on the down low at first because this is somebody who has been labelled as a thief. You wouldn't want to tell them that you were a spy in a previous life. You wouldn't want to do that. So that to me didn't, I didn't understand that, to be honest. That felt like a bit of an inconsistency. But, you know, at the end of the day, there we go. So, overall, it really isn't a good film, Mission Impossible 2. There's some entertaining moments, some isolated moments. I don't think it's a completely terrible film, but it's just not great. I wouldn't rush back to watch it. This is, I think, the second time I watched it. Yeah, so I'm gonna rate this one 5 out of 10. That being said, I'm looking forward to the next review, Mission Impossible 3, which is directed by J.J. Abrams, who has directed many famous films recently. The two Star Trek films, the new ones, Super 8, which is a lovely film, I need to review that, and of course Star Wars Episode 7, The Force Awakens. So, yeah, but that's my review of Mission Impossible 2. What do you think? Do you agree? Do you disagree? Put your comments down below, let me know. We can compare and contrast. And yeah, that's all for now. Thank you for watching. As always, I'm Mr. TARDIS 11. See ya.